Welcome to a very special Beyond the Waves exclusive interview with the green and white writer, once again, Paul Larkin. Hail, hail, Paul.
Hail, hail, Mr. Wilson. How are you?
I'm doing fantastic, and I'm excited to be back on the airwaves and back talking to you as well. Today, we're going to talk about your latest book. It's a novel. It's very exciting, called The IRA Block. Mm-hmm. And we're going to get right into it because I absolutely love this book. It was revealing. It was intense. It was graphic. And, you know, I mean, it just tells the tale. So, Paul, getting right to it, what inspired this book?
Well, I mean, obviously, clearly, living in New York was a huge inspiration. It was kind of something that I'd always had in mind. And bits and pieces, yeah, I'd slipped to various other mediums and stuff like that. But actually, the first inspiration I had in terms of actually putting the book out was I was reading an interview with Irvine Welsh, and he had brought out Skag Boys, which was the prequel to Trainspotting. Mm. And there was a really fascinating tale where what he had done was he had basically submitted that whole book, Skag Boys and Trainspotting, as Trainspotting with the publisher, which I think at the time was 140,000 words or so. And the publisher says to him, "You've never written a book before. Why would anybody want you to read 140,000 words from you?" which, funnily enough, I've heard before, and it's kind of my mantra. That's why I write books that are kind of like novelized fanzines, you know, you need fanzine size, A5, that kind of thing. Because I think there's only a limit that anybody can sort of expect to hold anybody's attention, you know? So what Irvine Welsh did was lop a lot of the start with it and resubmit it, and that's what became Trainspotting. So you had the book, Skagboy book, Graham, on like old Amstrad discs, if you remember them, you know, the Amstrad computer.
Sure, yeah.
And the hard discs they used to have. So what he did was he went on eBay, bought an old Amstrad that was being refurbished, rescued the work, and then polished it to his Skag Boys. So I thought, well, if he can do it, he's a fucking multi-millionaire, I can do it. So I thought, right, you know, I've got all this material here, let's polish it out, let's add a look to it. And it'll make it cheap. I mean, it's only going to be $8.99, I think it's $4.99 on Kindle. And hopefully it'll be like a summer read for people because, you know, when I was in New York, Graham, I met so many characters, some of which you've met yourself, obviously, people listening to it. And I thought, you know, these guys, like, they're my people in the sense that they're kind of working guys and girls who... Are just brilliant, you know. I think the analogy I'd make them is, I was talking to somebody about this. See, comedians now, stand-up comedians, by and large, are middle class,
right?
You know?
Right.
And they talk about things like I don't know if you're aware of a guy called Jack Whitehall, who played at Celtic Park last year in one of the charity games. But like, I've seen him in a couple of chat shows recently, and every story was like about, oh, this is the time I met Harrison Ford, and oh, this is the time I got Robert De Niro's autograph. And I'm thinking, that isn't what real people have any concept of whatsoever, myself included. Whereas the likes of Pryor, Billy Connolly, Bill Hicks, they talked about things that related to real people and real situations. And consequently, we all pissed ourselves laughing at them.
Right.
You know what I mean?
Because we could identify.
Yeah, exactly. You know, Connolly, especially for me, you know, people like Pryor for you, because they were telling the truth.
Right.
And so...
telling the truth, but also, you know, aware of, it's almost in a self-deprecating way, aware of their you know, their weaknesses or maybe even their own neurosis and being, you know, not taking themselves seriously, being okay with it and almost lifting that up on high, which, you know, that puts people at ease as well, because we all have our own insecurities and our own, you know, concerns about our own weaknesses, if you will. And that's disarming and endearing as well.
Yeah, you're right, exactly. And it's, you know, I've always kind of, I'm always lax to try and bring out something in my own, as opposed to like a big subject book, like, you know, anyone but Celtic or the Astroseers, because in my mind at the back is always like, well, who'll care? You know, and I totally understand that. I didn't expect anybody to care. And I think some people kind of forget that, you know, most people only give a fuck, you know?
Yeah.
But another thing on the Richard Pryor thing, Graham, was that I've watched him in his course. You better see it yourself. He's in the sort of deep south in like the early 80s. And the whole concert, right, was basically people heckling him. Not necessarily racist stuff like that, but just thinking they were funnier than him.
Right.
You know?
Right.
Which obviously is utter shite. But I thought that's like Twitter.
Exactly. Exactly.
you see he'll do anything and it's like people just I thought, well, you know what? I want to do this. I love doing it. So why not just do it? And if it sells nothing,
yep.
So what?
Fuck it.
But, you know, I'm proud of the book. I've seen the first copies in the last week. It looks good. Phenomenally adapted by David Harper.
Mm.
Great cover by Cartuja. And, you know, I looked at it and I thought, yeah, that's good. And so, you know, I'm kind of trying to build up people to give me advice on that. I'll talk about it because, like, for example, I've given three people the book at the minute, not including yourself. And next week we're going to meet and do a podcast and talk about the book and what they thought about it. And the only condition I made, and you could ask them when you find out who they are, is that I told them, when you finish the book, don't tell me anything about it.
Mm, yeah.
Don't say, oh, I was good at that. I didn't want to have any preconception, nor did I want to sort of subconsciously influence what you're going to say, because
right.
I want it to be real. If you thought it was shite, say it was shite and say why,
mm-hmm.
you know?
Yeah.
And things like that. So I've got to do that next Saturday, and hopefully that'll be good. But with the content, as you kind of touched on at the start, it is graphic, but it's also real.
Mm.
And I've just felt, you know, Chaz Duffy said that every time I've seen him, keep it real.
Mm-hmm.
And that's how I've always kind of thought about things, you know?
Yeah, yeah. And, you know, I mean, let's be honest. So many cult classic films they do have shocking imagery and topics and screenplay. And we love them for those aspects, for the fact that they are so real. And there is a certain level of, I don't know if you want to call it escapism. I mean, that's part of why we read, especially, you know, in the fiction realm. And that's why we go to the movies. I mean, you know, you look at Goodfellas and all the scenes of, you know, what they were up to, the Lufthansa heist, you know, all the way down to the hits they were making. And, you know, it's something where... there is a level of interest there. It does take us away from our own comfort level. But, you know, to your point, when, you know, these guys are you know, I guess off duty, if you will, or off the clock, it's a weird a reference to make with regard to that. But they are just normal, you know, they interact in many of the same ways that we do. And it just, there is that kind of interesting pull there. Now, this book talks a lot about that underground within New York. Tell us a little bit about that. Give us some of the color around, you know, the state of play, the atmosphere, the goings on, etc.
Well, I mean, in terms of the context of the book, so you have a Scottish guy going to New York and he kind of hits the ground running and he gets kind of pulled into this underworld. So without even realizing it to begin with, and it kind of analogy I'd make is, you know, it's right. If you're flying in a plane and all of a sudden all the engines go for a while, that's the best thing that happens because you're actually flying, you know, on your own. But of course, at some point, you've got to crash, and that's kind of like the analogy for this book. So when I got to New York, which was 10 years ago now, to live there, I've been there before, obviously. I became acutely aware of what I would call an almost like a second government, which was the organisation of certain crime families and associates and people like that who had their hands into everything.
Mm-hmm.
And people, you know, would say, you know, you hear people say, no, I've never had anything to do with them. And you say, well, who collects your garbage?
Right, you already are.
When was the last time you were in the garment district?
Yeah.
What bars do you drink in? What restaurants do you go to? And you'll find that they are there. Now, being from Scotland myself, my kind of experience of that kind of like was movies, which is probably the most for everybody, and books and stuff like that.
Yeah.
So you do expect, as you touched on, this Goodfellas type world where everybody's wearing suits and kissing each other on the cheek and... or Godfather, where they're kissing each other on the ring and stuff like that. But that's not the reality in modern organised crime anymore, because, you know, They are not sitting in social clubs waiting for the FBI to arrest them. You know?
Right.
They are out there, and they're all gainfully employed, and they're all kind of family people and all that kind of thing. But they have a dynamic in them of, I'd say to you, it's extreme would be a lot of them are sociopaths.
Mm-hmm.
But then there's the other aspect, the other end, which is they're good people to know if you're in a situation that you need bailed out of.
Hell yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
Now, so what would happen would be, and just things like, you would do things, there's a couple of things I've done in my life in New York, which I got in trouble for, which I don't think you'd get in trouble anywhere else on the planet for. I'd always been a fan of these Yankee t-shirts, which was a dark blue with a Yankee badge, and it had a name of a player and the number on the back,
mm-hmm.
because they were cheap and they were good quality, yeah, for any club, of course.
Yeah.
And you get 15, 20 bucks at the Sports Authority. I walked in one day to a location where there were certain people there, and the guy looked at me like I'd walked in with a fucking screenshot of his mother on my t-shirt.
Oh, Jesus.
I said, what? And he was like, where'd you get that? I said, Sports Authority. And I thought he was going to have some dig about the Yankees or something, you know? And he said, what the fuck's wrong with you? And I said, I don't know. What is it? And he says, don't ever go into there again. I'll get you them. And 2 days later, I was 16 t-shirts came to my house.
Yeah, no need to do full retail, brother.
Yeah.
You know.
And the other one, it was probably, because I don't want to, Sabathia, and the whole fucking dad old lineup basically choose me.
Yeah.
The second one was I went to a certain strip club in Queens, walked in, no problem, everything great, etc. And kind of, you know, like any man, bemused by these beautiful women and music and everything going on and stuff like that. It's fantastic. Walked to the bar, ordered the drinks, went to put my hand in my pocket and felt a vice like grip on my hand. I was like, what the fuck? And it was a friend of mine said, what the fuck are you doing? And I said, I'm buying drinks. And he's like, don't embarrass me. I said, what? And he went, this is my club, you're my guest, sit down and shut the fuck up. And I was like, wait, back to another friend. I said, I think this guy's going to kill me. He said, no, it's fine, don't worry about it.
Yeah.
You know, so that's the kind of level they were on. And things like, you know, when I remember writing an article, we've spoken about this before, about 9/11 and my understanding of 9/11, having lived in America, had changed dramatically. And I was getting merciless abuse of people about it.
Naturally.
You know, Huns and things, basically.
Yeah.
And told one of these guys, and he was just like, what? I'll fucking sort it out right now for you. And I was like, well, whatever, it's Twitter, it could be anybody, this, that, next thing. I said, it could be anywhere. And he turned me straight in the eye and said, look, Paul, we're a worldwide organisation. You know, and we just go, all right, cool. So, you know, seeing all these stories firsthand, plus being a bit Mario Puzo, just kind of hanging about and hearing things and all that, I thought, right, if I write this right, if I didn't point at anything that could incriminate anyone, and if I try to kind of sort of colour the humour and the situations and effectively show how someone like the character in the book can go from going to New York to being around these guys, then I think I'm on a winner here, like, you know?
Yeah.
And trying to effectively drag the reader into the situation, you know, it's a kind of fast-paced book. It's very well lit and brightly coloured and loud and stuff like that. And so I thought, right, this is a great way to kind of let people know about these characters and characters that I encountered. Because, you know, probably every one of them you could write an autobiography about, but, you know what I mean, the stories that they have and all that, but they're not the kind of people who seek fame or publicity, shall we say. So I thought I could add that in and add in some of my own experiences or maybe stories that I'd heard within New York, and come up with something that people would like, you know, I guess, for the summer read, you know.
Well, when you talk about, and it's a perfect summer read, you bring that up, and it's, like you say, it's fast-paced, it's fun, it's easy to read, it goes by seemingly quickly, you know, chapter to chapter. You talk about characters just there, and one of the big personalities and one of the big presences within this book is Tommy, a huge, yeah. huge personality. But much of it rings familiar. Is this based off of a real person?
It is, yeah. It is. that's not his real name, obviously, but he was probably, how could I put it, the rock upon which the book was written, this guy. So, you know, he was what I would call your modern day mob guy, if you like, right?
Okay.
So, completely, and I've never seen guys like him and other guys portrayed like that anywhere apart from, portrayed like what they actually are like, apart from probably Sopranos.
Mm, mm-hmm.
Sopranos got close to that because it showed that they weren't just like 24-hour-a-day gangsters.
Right.
They had families and kids and jobs and problems and all sorts of shit like that. And I wanted to really bring him to life and also bring his character and personality to life.
Mm.
Because, you know, people like that, it's they're absolutely phenomenal. For anything that they've done, you know, that might be, let's say, a kind of stray from normative life, they're unbelievable company.
Yeah, you know? I can imagine. Jesus.
And you can go anywhere with them.
Yeah.
And they're lauded and respected and all that. And also, they do not let you down.
Yeah.
You know, in your time you need.
Well, it's honor.
You don't.
Yeah, you know, exactly. I mean, they know what that means and they take it very seriously.
Absolutely. Absolutely. And so, you know, I thought, right, I can construct this whole thing and he's kind of the yang to the yin, the main character. But, you know, as the book goes on, you see his involvement and you see, even in the darkest moments, he still humour comes out of things and stuff like that, which is exactly what this person's like. But also what he's like is a kind of guy who you can take any problem whatsoever and it gets solved.
Yeah.
And that's rare these days. That is rare. People call it old school, you know, and all that kind of thing, but it's more than that. It's about respect, you know what I mean? And it should be like what everybody's like, taken away from that lifestyle. Because the other thing about like the organized crime is, especially, is that everybody always thinks it's just a gang of murderers,
right?
Right, which just is not the case. I've never seen or heard really anything like that.
Mm-hmm.
What I would say is it's a gang of thieves.
Yep.
You know.
Yep.
Now you can, I mean, that's obviously people can say, "Oh, fuck them." Then, well, fine. You know, that's it's a book for entertainment purposes. It's not a moral fucking academic piece on the modern day mafia.
Right.
It's kind of trying to show different aspects of their life and how they think about things and how they say things and how they, from things that I saw, you know, just even when they were watching things like The View, you know, in America, and some of the comments about, you know, various other things, is that I thought they were really, really funny because, you know, there's also, I was told once by a guy that there was two types of people in the New York Mafia. There was guys who could hit and there was guys who could make money.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And if you met a guy that didn't look like he had much money, beware. You know.
Right, right. Yeah, exactly. Yeah. There's only one other possibility.
Yeah. So, you know, and that was it. And also, you know, various kind of sort of situations and that, but you know, as I say, the overriding factor, as I want to put across, was that this guy was, you know, there's a Greek proverb at the start of the book about Icarus.
Yep.
You know, fly too high or if he flies too low, that kind of thing, and this is the situation this guy's in, because, you know, it's like anything, Graham, you know, if you're coming from a situation where nothing's really going on and you're not having much luck with anything, and then you're in a situation where money and drugs and women and bars are all at the touch of a button, at your fingertips. We could all sit here and say, wouldn't it change me whatsoever? Wouldn't it be affected? Wouldn't it be tempted? But when you're put in that situation, you know, I think Chris Rock sums up when he says about men who cheat, he says, a man's as faithful as his options.
Right.
That's kind of like this, where, you know, and I think that came from a big fat guy saying to him, oh, I would never cheat my wife. And he said, you know, it's like, yeah, in construction, yeah, but you didn't get the kind of women that I get thrown themselves at me.
Right, exactly. What are you going to do in that situation?
Yeah. So this was, you know, a young single guy coming from Scotland in this situation, go, well, you know, let's bite the big apple here, you know?
Yeah. Yeah, and one of the impressions that I got from this book that I loved and I connected with immediately, I noticed immediately, and I appreciated it as the book went on, was the fact that this was not just written from somebody that had researched the topic and had talked to people that were within it. There were so many anecdotes throughout this book that, you know, myself growing up in Philadelphia, I mean, it's not New York, but it's sort of like the kid brother of New York, where many of the same customs and vernacular and colloquialisms all are present, you know, within my childhood and upbringing as well. And one of them was that I absolutely loved was you talk about there was a scene in the book where there was a discussion around the water in New York being better than everywhere else, and that's the reason why pizza tastes better in New York. And if we could just take the water elsewhere, you know, we could take New York water to Florida and make pizza out of the New York water, then we, you know, we'd be fucking millionaires. And it's like, it's something that, you know, we didn't hear New York water in Philly, but we heard it was the same thing. It was like, well, Philly water is the reason why, you know, the cannolis taste better, or the bread tastes better, or whatever. And it's just like, and you know, there was just one thing after another that really it's something that's going to resonate with people that are from New York. Like if somebody reads this from New York or involved in many of the same scenarios that you're describing, they're going to be able to identify with it and judge it as authentic. But it also paints the picture for people that maybe have never even been to New York before and are following along with the storyline.
Yeah, I mean, I think that you know, that type of discussion was something I was party to a lot. You know, I was just guys sitting at the table thinking up the next scheme. You know, what's the next way we're going to make money? You know, that kind of thing. That happened a lot. But also, I think I've met, not necessarily people who are involved in organized crime, but I've met these types of characters all over the world, you know?
Yeah.
I've met them in Philly. I've sat down with, like, say, yourself and Scott Richards, and it's like that. Jimmy Olvera in California is like that.
Yeah.
These guys, like, you look at them, and they have got, pardon a Philly pun, the eye of the tiger. You know, they get in these situations and they do not fucking hesitate. Like, they don't. And that's, they're all over the world. You know, they're literally all over the world. And I love people like that. And a lot of people kind of back off to people like that.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
But, I mean, I'll give you an example. If someone's, like, if you think about somebody like Paul Lee, who we both know, right? Now, Paul is somebody that I've said in the book, and I'll say again, that a lot of people just get a white birthday, right? But I've seen in him, I can see in his eyes what he's really about, and he's had tough times recently, and like we all do, and whatever, but he's still the same person.
Right.
You know? So, I like to think that we can do this, like that me and you, or me and the homeboys, or whoever, we can beat each other up, you know, verbally and talk shit and fight and argue and all that. But we all remember that we're still the same people.
Right.
You know, that, like, so you're talking shit and blah, 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 back forth, which we've done 1,000 times. But if you came to me or vice versa and said, listen, I'm in trouble, this has happened, that's happened, I need your help, I'd like to think we'd all be like, you know, fuck the arguments.
I'm fucking there.
Help.
Yeah.
And that's it. And that's, this has become a lost art, I think, whereas we've all sort of, we're also opinionated now that sometimes it's great to just sit and chat and tell stories and have a drink in bars and that. And a lot of that is in this book in terms of what I've done.
Yeah.
But the other thing is that, I mean, you've been in New York, you know it's New York. It's New York. Anything can happen.
Right.
Like, you know what I mean?
That is true.
And you can meet all sorts of fucking people. And I tried to put in as many of these kind of people as I could. And just stories that I heard. You know, one example was the one where the cop, this is a true story, a cop told me that he went to a place in Queens, I think it was, to bust what they were told was a brothel. And as it transpired, when they realised what they'd went into, it was actually a lesbian couple, one of whom was doing tricks to make money so that our partner, who had breast cancer, could get treatment.
Jesus Christ.
And he was so moved by the story after checking it out, he left $400.
Yeah.
Which, when you hear that story, is fucking, like, holy fuck, that's lovely. That's, you know, that's commitment to your partner. But when he told that story amongst a few guys, there was a pause, and one of the guys said, so what'd you get for the $400 then?
Oh, Jesus Christ. <You
know>? Oh. Now, I know, listen, see that reaction you just gave, that a lot of people would be like, the fuck, see, that's outrageous. But that's the cutting thing.
Right, right. You
know, it's like, nothing's fucking off limits kind of thing.
Right.
And I never done anything, but, you know, it's just funny to even suggest it.
No, that's New York, man. I mean, you know, that's the knife edge humor, you know, that comes out. I mean, it manifests itself in Bust the Balls, or, you know, like that right on the edge, you know, kind of dark humor. But that's what identifies New York so much, especially for the people like yourself that have lived there for years and years. I mean, you know, the shock value goes up and you immerse yourself into what New York is, and it becomes part of you, doesn't it?
It does. I mean, it does become part of you, and yet, I mean, for somebody like me, it was like, there was quite a lot of times I was thinking, this is paradise, like, I can't even believe this. But you see, so it's like every day, I mean, there's a guy in the book, who it's based on a true guy, every bar he drank in Midtown Manhattan, he drank for free, and nobody could tell me why. Like, why is this like, you know? And so he was kind of a bit of respected and loving, great guy, and he used to work at Madison Square Garden in the 70s, so he had seen all the bands, and met all the bands, and had all stories about all the bands, and I could have just sat and listened to them all night. But, so we're sitting, and this kind of sums up the kind of mentality of the Tommy character. We're sitting one night in a bar, and talking about him, and saying what a great guy he is, and what a laugh, and all that kind of thing. And at that moment, he walked in, and there was a long sort of corridor to come to the main bar, and I seen Tommy look at him and say, what the fuck, and I was like, what's wrong with him? Steams over to him and rips the jacket right off his back. So what the fuck? He says, he's wearing a Man United jacket. I said, all right. This guy's fucking standing there in the bar going, what the fuck's happened here? I've just walked to the bar, somebody whipped a jacket right off the thing. You know, I was just like, what the... And, but, you know, 2 minutes before, he was like, greatest guy in the world.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? So I tried to put loads of that kind of anecdote, because that's, you know me, that's my style, is to... I like to tell stories that it's like it's me telling you in a bar, you know, and try and draw people in like that. But also there's a darker edge to the book, and there's a kind of more serious edge to the book in terms of what ends up happening to the guy and so on. And there is times where, you know, it's really scary for that, and I try to really bring people into that fear of your world collapsing, you know, around you. Let's just, you know, if you came home one day and suddenly everything you took for granted had went tits up, what would you do, how would you feel, etc. And I tried to put that in to the book as much as possible so that people could actually understand what's happening, you know?
Yeah, and that's part of the journey as well. I mean, it has almost has that, like, catch me if you can apex, you know, where you take the reader through the entire process, you know, like you said, coming to New York, and New York is just absolutely, it's like a 180 from where you came from. And you know, you talk about 10 years prior, and then, you know, things really start to take off in New York, and the exploits, and believe me, there are exploits, Jesus. But, you know, and then you take yourself to that peak, to that apex, and then, you know, to tell that story about, you know, the impact and where it all goes. I mean, it's quite the ride. Let me ask you, when you are, obviously it's a work of fiction, but it's based off of your experiences. When you're writing in kind of a fictitious tilt, if you will, but it's influenced off of your experiences and you know, your thoughts. Do you ever get self-reflective in a, I don't want to say judgmental way, but do you ever read that and you're like, Jesus, like, what the fuck was I up to? Like, what am I thinking?
I mean, when I'm writing these kind of things, like, the thing that I'm best at writing is dialogue, you know? Mm-hmm. People have, you know, English teachers and university have taught, you're fucking phenomenal at dialogue, like, which, of course, is a backhand way to say, you're not that great at anything else. You know? I can totally accept that. So, you know, but I'm kind of, and the reason I can do that is I have the ability, and I don't know how everybody has this ability, to, if I'm writing a character, I can hear their inner voice talking in there, whether it's American accent, Irish, or whatever. And I can write like that. But I mean, to be quite honest with you, and this is an absolutely true story, Graham, when I first went to New York, it was like, hit the ground running and then some, and quite a lot of that was jet-fueled by Guinness, right?
Naturally.
To the point where I was ending up in so many fucking bizarre and possibly dangerous situations that the Tommy character said to me, you know, you really should stop drinking that Guinness for a wee bit and just drink something lighter, because every single night something's happening, like, you know?
Yeah.
Because, you know, it was a melting pot of the Guinness, having a few quid in your pocket, being in New York and having a fresh start. And it was like the perfect storm, you know?
Mm-hmm.
I'm up for anything. And that's kind of what happened to a lot of stuff. Because you do, you know, it's like when you go on holiday, you know? It's like you fucking go nuts, don't you? But then you go home after 2 weeks. Well, that stayed for almost 6 years. Okay? So it's kind of like, fucking hell, you need to screw the nut and stuff like that. But I used to always... I really had a knack of upsetting people. You know, the worst people to upset, like a friend of mine's wife. You know, so
yeah.
I'm in a bar one time, and this girl started sort of to come out, and she was absolutely stunning, right? And he was like, I'm going home, and I was staying with this guy at the time, and he was like, I said, no, I'm fine, just leave me, I'm cool here, wink, wink. No, you need to come, I said, no, just fucking go, I'll get a hotel room. Naively thinking, I've got $75 in my pocket, I'll be able to get a hotel room in Manhattan, no problem. Yeah, so, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
So for whatever reason, it didn't happen with this girl, and I thought, fuck's sake. So this is making me sound really good, by the way. I just want to say that up front. I latched on to this other girl who I thought might have been more receptive to her, to me going back with her. And she was kind of receptive up to the point of me going back to her. I was like, great. And so I was like, fuck it. I said to the guy, I texted him the details, and I said, you know, I'll get the bus home. What time? He's like, don't worry, I'll come in and get you. And I thought, nah.
Jesus Christ.
So at 3 a.m, he got up, has to get up and tell his wife.
Ugh.
You know, and I just thought, oh, fuck. And so, you know, things were a wee bit touchy, shall we say, and things like that. Because it's like anything, Graham. Like, it would be like me coming over to your house tomorrow, and, you know, you've obviously, you've got a child, you've got one on the way, you're happily married, etc. But, you know as well as I do, if I come over there for, say, like 2 weeks, I'm not want to be sitting in the house every night with you playing Happy Families. I want to go out and whatever.
Right.
And you feel obliged.
Right.
I'm telling you now, it'll be 4 days before your wife's ready to come. Because I represent a threat to that Happy Family situation you have. Because suddenly I've taken you and made you feel like you're 25 again.
Right.
You know, because we're just two guys out drinking beers and having a laugh. Which,
right.
You know. It's something I didn't deal with these days as you get older.
Yeah.
Because everybody's married and busy and this and that and all that kind of thing. So that can be a problem. But New York has something for everything. Something for everyone, you know.
Mm.
And that's why I tried to put as much of it as possible in this book, you know.
Well, you certainly didn't hold back. I don't want to give too much away. But, you know, once again, it's the storyline tends to gravitate again and again to the graphic nature, and you know, it gets into what we were talking about before, the real sense of it all. But, you know, once again, we are, you know, brought into you know, the graphic nature of the storyline. Why do you think that, you know, you have an affinity for, you know, for taking the storyline in that direction?
Well, I think that's a good question, actually.
I mean, do you think it's maybe like the influence of Irvin Welsh at all? Like, you know, I mean, because, you know, we brought up Skag Boys and Trainspotting as well. And, you know, specifically in Trainspotting, I mean, you know, the guy wakes up and he shit the bed. I mean, you know, it's stuff like that, again, like we were talking about with Goodfellas. Those are the types of things that's like, oh, my God, you know, that there is a sense of escapism with it. Is it deliberate from that context?
I think, I mean, first of all, I would say, yeah, I mean, Irvin Welsh is a huge inspiration to me, primarily because, you know, he's from the same area I am, and the stuff that he writes is, I can totally relate to, because, you know, I know the areas and stuff, and it's something that I've studied, actually. People who watch things on TV and stuff, where they see people they know or places they know, it makes them feel good,
you
know?
Yeah.
I've also been someone, and I'm sure you can taste it, I don't get embarrassed by anything. So I can have conversations about anything,
yeah,
sex, drugs, rock and roll, whatever it might be. And I'm not going to be like, oh my God, blushing and all that kind of thing. But lastly, I think it's because I just have such an affinity for real people, you know?
Mm-hmm.
People who have nails or graces or bullshit. And I know that they are not just a dying breed, but they're almost getting isolated from society because people are offended by everything now.
Yeah.
So, sometimes you can kind of, it's like, you know, let's put it this way, I've been in situations with other couples or whatever, who, you know, when I've been talking or that, and I just know the minute I leave, one of the couples got to say, for fuck's sake, do they have to say this or do they have to say, you know, and I'm not like that at all. I didn't like people talking behind people's backs and talking shite and whatever. And if people are talking shite, I'll call them out to their face or on Twitter or whatever. You know, and they're interested, oh, he's a prick and all that kind of thing. Because at the end of the day, Graham, I think as you get older, you understand that pretty much everything can be sorted with a conversation, you know, if we step back to things. But also, there has to be reality.
Yeah.
You know, because we live in an age of so-called reality TV.
Right.
But, you know, how much are the Kardashians a reality to you?
Ah, oh, fuck's sake. I mean, how much of it's reality to them as well? It's all scripted.
Yeah,
or you know,
anyone,
it's,
you
yeah,
know?
Yeah.
Your reality, and I sit and listen and go back to the point of comedians. Though I love listening to working class authors and working class filming. You know, Ken Loach just got the Palme d'Or there and stuff like that.
Yeah.
These are my inspirations. These are my heroes because there are so many characters out there that you can build stories around now. And I think that I was ready to write another novel because since my last novel, I've had 4 years of education. I'm into a third year at university now. I've been taught different things. I understand things better. And, you know, hopefully that gets reflected in the writing. But I'm also interested. Like, Irvin Welsh's thing is, he'll tell you himself, he's interested in stories that are people who are going on the right path in their life, and then all of a sudden they go down the wrong way, and instead of turning back, they just keep going.
Yeah.
And keep descending. Whereas I am interested, my thing is, I am interested in people who actually are working class, but in their own little way change the world of people. You know, whether that's Elvis, Stevie Chalmers, whoever, or Frankie Fraser, you know?
Right.
Because Frankie Fraser, you know, who you know, Queens,
sure,
changed my world because of, you know, his, I've said it before, he's kind of like a New York underground tour guide, you know? So he can tell you in 5 minutes who's the good guys, who's the bad guys, where to go, where not to go, and so on and so on and so on.
Unless you're talking about baseball.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Well, everybody's got their flaws. But the other aspect of it is, if anything comes to you, he'll stand in front of you.
Right.
Now, that's no, you can't really say that about a lot of people, Graham.
No.
You know?
No.
You know, it's kind of like, and I didn't mean, I'm not meant that to be a macho thing. And I didn't mean it just be somebody flinging a fist at you, he'll stand in front of you. But in any kind of aspect of your life.
Right.
And that, these are the people that I'm drawn to because they're real and they're kind of urban and they're working class and they just know the rules. You know, and the rules, you know, the rules that I'm trying to stick to all in my life that are things like never cross a picket line, you know,
mm-hmm.
never trust the police, you know, yeah. all that kind of thing.
Yeah.
And even in our kind of wee worlds, the rules of, you know, do you want to go for a drink? Well, I've no money. I never asked you if you had money. You know, if I want, I'll buy, no problem. Declare yourself, find no problem. It's just wee things like that.
Yeah.
And when I see that in people, you know, and stuff like that, and I've met so many people, you know, especially in the last few years, where it's just like, you know, oh, what's how much is this? Is it Bill's taking care of? What? And it just, I just love people like that. No, but it's not just because, you know, oh, you get a free meal or you get a free drink. Because I'll do the same for them. But these are the people there. These are the real heroes of life. They're out there helping people every single day. They didn't want recognition. They didn't seek recognition. But I'm trying to give them recognition, you know?
Yeah, yeah. One thing that I wanted to ask you about as well, and that I noticed, and I found it fascinating, and maybe this was just something that I alone noticed, but it seemed as if you, and you've done this in other works as well, but there were certain aspects where you used more of the Scottish vernacular than others, and it almost went in and out of it. You know, there would be a chapter where the vernacular would be more neutral, so to speak, and it mm-hmm. almost mirrored, you know, your time, I guess the time that you had spent in New York, and you mentioned that you had to acclimate your yeah. you know, your manner of speech, but there were also times when you'd go back to a more thicker sort of Scottish you know, terminology, colloquialisms, etc. Was that deliberate? Did I just read into yeah. that?
I mean, there is a bit where that is highlighted. I did have to change my accent and change the way I spoke, which, of course, you have to remember, that's always caveated with the fact that anybody from Scotland who hears that automatically assumes you're a prick.
Right.
You know what I mean? So...
But ask them to spend, you know, a month in New York and not do the same. I have to do the same, and I'm from Philly.
It's like you're an alien, nobody understands you, and blah, blah, blah. But I'll give you an example. One of the things is, you know, you go to a bar and you say, can I have a hamburger, please? Now, everybody understands hamburger, right? But then they'll say, how would you like it? I mean, you know this. How would you like it cooked? And I would say, medium. And they would just look at me, what? what they need, you see, was medium. But I would automatically say medium.
Right.
Like M-E-J-U-M.
Right.
That's what it sounds like. Right. And they would just stare at you fucking blankly, like, you know? That was a process. And I did kind of, I looked at it in the book, but that's what I had to do, the character and stuff like that. And the other thing I'd done, which is a big Scottish thing, was, I don't know if you'd picked up on it or not, that people will, is that I highlighted the price in every drink,
yes.
every bar.
I know.
Because that is exactly what Scottish people do.
Yep, yeah.
You say to them, they were in Benidorm, good holiday. Ah, it was absolutely brilliant. Found a wee boozer, it was only €2 a pint. In Benidorm, you have a good holiday, that was garbage. €5 a pint.
That's so funny.
That's exactly what they do. And so I thought that has to be something that... Because if I still date myself, like, you know, is it, you go to a new bar, wherever it might be, I was in Liverpool this week, and I always say, you know, how much was that? You know, how much was that ring? And I say, oh, it was £6.30. That's quite good, that, you know. If you come back and say, oh, it was £11.80, like, what the fuck?
Fuck's
sake. You know, it's just one of the things I've always done, like, you know what I mean? That's kind of Scottish. So, I mean, I had to be the Scottish, because it's not just a kind of uniquely American book, you know, there's Scottish tendencies. I think there's only one reference to Celtic in the whole book, but, you know, I just tried to give people what that experience is of, because it is, as you said before, it's like literally no one understands you. Because you know yourself, US people, by and large, are not exposed to Scottish people.
Right.
So, you know, you get quite often, you'll say, where'd you come from? And you'll say, Scotland. Where's that? Who comes through there? Sean Connery? Nah, never heard of him. Billy Connolly? Nah, never heard of him. Shrek. Oh, Shrek! You know,
is that near England?
Quite often I would get asked by people, how did you get here? By aeroplane?
Right.
As if you were going to see spaceship.
Right,
know,
right. A slingshot. You know, I had to remove the face paint, you know, before I was allowed through customs and, you know.
There's one thing I did as well, which I don't know if you noticed, and this is something I noticed, and this might have just been me that noticed this about Americans, or in particular New Yorkers, right? Is that every time I mentioned the word Florida in the book, I put fucking before it.
That's so true.
Fucking Florida. So The reason I've done that was, like, people in New York now, every single one of them, all they ever did was go to Florida for their holidays.
Right.
Yet they all seem to absolutely despise it.
Yep, yeah.
Too hot, too this, too that. And so they would always preface it with, that's fucking Florida, fucking Florida, fucking Florida. And I'm just like, what the fuck? So I thought, I'm going to have to put that in the book because...
It's so true.
I'm not really sure people from the East Coast understand that other holiday destinations are available.
Yeah,
you know?
Yeah, exactly. And you know what the thing is? If you go to Florida, for all of those who have been to Florida, many Scottish people, look, I still go on Twitter and everybody's going on and on about, you know, their holidays and going to Orlando, as if Orlando. Anyway, I'll leave it there. But you go to Florida and it's like all the same fucking people from New York are there. Yeah. You know, so it's like you're going away on holiday, and it's like you haven't gone away. Like, you're around the same people. It's just the weather's different and fucking Mickey Mouse is up your ass. But other than that, it's New York.
That's why, and it's same for Boston Philly, but you know, the Mets and Yankees, when they play down there, they're always massively supported because there's so many New Yorkers and Bostonians and Philly people, you know, in Florida that have retired. I mean, because everybody, it's always, you know, there's a one guy in particular every year, Florida, 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 and then moan like fuck about it. And then so he's looking at, so what's that? Like, say, I'm looking at houses in Florida, that's where I'll probably retire. Thinking, why? You hate the place.
Because everybody fucking does. That's what you do.
And also, the thing about Florida, I'm meeting Florida myself, is, and I think the good point you make about Orlando is, I loved Orlando, fucking absolutely phenomenal place. But you know yourself, that's not really what Florida's like.
Right.
Elsewhere.
Right.
You know, it's neat, let's just say it's neat coincidence the Republicans rely on it. to win elections, you know?
Yeah, no question about it. The book is The IRA Block. We're talking to Paul Larkin. You can find The IRA Block up until May 31st, £10 anywhere in the world on PayPal. We still won at hotmail.com.
Yeah, £10 on PayPal, we still won at hotmail.com, and I will ship a signed copy anywhere in the world before Tuesday.
That's fantastic.
And then get out there. And then after that, it'll be on general release on lulu.com, 24th of June, $8.99. And you can order it or pre order it for your Kindle or Amazon right now at $4.99.
Thank you, Paul. And I thoroughly enjoyed reading this. I'm a bit disappointed, I'll be honest, because you know I read the book in preparation for our chat today, but I kind of wish I would have saved it for the beach and or for, you know, holidays. And who am I fucking kidding? I'm not doing holidays anyway. But you know, yeah. I strongly encourage.
One way to fix that, Graham, just buy another one.
Absolutely. I will have to do so. So, Paul, thank you.
Somebody said that to me. He said, I've never been asked this before. I mean, I get probably, I'm not, me talking about, I probably get asked 150 questions a day. No, most of them know about books or anything, but definitely. And a guy asked me a question on Thursday or said something to me. I've never had anybody say to me in my life as someone who writes books. He said, you've got a new book out? And I said, yeah. And he said, I'd buy it, but I didn't know anything about the story. I said, well, it's on the back. And he went, aye, but I'd like to have read it first. I mean, how do you answer that? Like, I don't know. It's like, go to the movies, but I'd like to see this film first before I pay for it. It's all fun and games.
It is a new world that we live in, isn't it? I mean,
it's a brave new world.
It is.
It's a world that nobody expects to pay for anything in, so... That's why you kind of go, oh, this is $15.99. People think, fuck off.
Yeah.
You know, it's like, I get my fucking movies free, and I get this free, and I get that free. I don't know what it means. So
it's the neoliberal post-capitalistic devolution into whatever. Into a Donald Trump-fueled Armageddon.
Yeah, it's like I was getting something for, what was it? I can't remember the context there. Talking about television or some, you know, people are always downloading things, and I didn't hear that. And a guy who's like this badgering me on Twitter, he's like, you know, you need to get this Cody stick and this and that, and get all your films for free, and it's fucking, it might be a bit dodgy. And I'm like, mate, I make films about corruption.
Right.
I cannot then download films illegally without being a fucking hypocrite. You know what I mean?
Right.
As much as I would like to, that's, you know, you can't, you know, you just imagine the fucking 404 movie, like, bastards wanting us to fucking, what, he used to fucking buy films and he's still getting them for free.
That would make for weeks of blogs about you.
Yeah, and you know, quite often people, where can I download, you know, they'll ask me, where can I download the app this year for free? I say, right after you, well, you can imagine what I say for that.
Oh, God. Well, Paul, listen, there's so much going on right now. Within Celtic. I mean, it's such an exciting time, and it's a perfect time for me to you know, get back in touch with you and us to have this discussion. I can't remember a time when there was so much excitement around the club, and obviously Brendan Rodgers coming in. You were there on the day, and you had some exclusive access. Share some of your thoughts, because I think universally people are excited and energized about the appointment, but... What sort of color can you add that you know maybe we haven't been exposed to, or what are your impressions?
Well, first of all, my initial impression of the main series there is that somebody somewhere, probably Dermot Desmond, has flicked a switch at that club and said, you know what, I don't think we're going to fuck about anymore. And that's why all of a sudden you get Brendan Rodgers, you get his backroom staff, you get a decent budget, and you get season tickets flying out the door. And, you know, we can all be cynical and talk about Sevco and this and all these different things, but I'm telling you, Graham, you know, I started going to Celtic Park in 1978. I've never experienced a day like I did on Monday at Celtic Park. 15,000 people turning out for a new manager.
It's incredible.
I mean, and these people sat there in that stand from 3:30 to 6:00 to hear Brendan Rodgers say words for about 6 or 7 minutes, and everybody left happy.
Yeah.
So what I take from that, Graham, is they're all out there. You know, you just need to give them something.
Exactly.
And that's how you run football clubs. And I think that's what we're trying to do. I know that there's kind of, you know, the big issue, or the sort of semi-issue that now kind of beats Bumble is the Resolution 12 things. And it kind of pains me to say, oh, we need to do this, we need to do that. It's, you know, the guy, the requisitioners have done everything they can, the club has done everything they can. At the minute, I think they're waiting on just the rest 12 guys saying off a few things regarding the legalities with a lawyer, and then you'll get an official statement. So that's good. EBT obviously is a live, ongoing case. Can't speak about that. Mm-hmm. You know, they like speaking about OJ 6 months into the trial, say, I think he's guilty. Well, Johnny Coughlin's just got him, yeah, a mistrial. See you later.
Right.
You know,
right.
So we need to think on that. But what I think has happened is the club have now become aware of the fact that there was a disconnect with the fans. There did have to be action, and it is now changing. You know, it's slowly but surely it is now changing. What impressed me with Brendan Rodgers is Brendan Rodgers came in with all the right credentials. Is, you know, this guy is a dyed-in-the-wheel Celtic supporter.
Yeah.
You know, and has been all his life, as are all his family. But he was quick to put the caveat in that. He says, I know I've got a lot of credit here. He says, but I'm not taking it for granted. I know I need to win football matches.
Right.
You know? And I thought, right, that's good. Mm-hmm. And he says, I also know I have to play entertaining football, and I also know I need to fill that ground. Well, I'm delighted to say I found out today that the banners have come down for the Lisbon Lions stand because these seats are starting to sell.
Fantastic.
That's phenomenal.
Yeah.
Because the knock-on effect to that is, I mean, it's absolutely, you know yourself, it's enormous. Not just for Celtic Park in terms of how many people are there, how much encouragement that gives a team, how much that adds to the transfer budget, how much that helps us hopefully get into the Champions League. That brings people back to your supporters club. You know, that brings guys out to support the club in Washington and in Philly and in York and Boston and Sonoma County because they want to watch Celtic.
Absolutely.
Celtic pulled a big name out of the hat at a time where we were kind of like, is this, you know? And I would think that the knock-on effect is huge in that. And as you say, I mean, you touched on the right to start with them. The last time you felt this excited, this positive and all that. And of course there are issues, there are always going to be issues. But big picture, the club, to me, it's just moving. I mean, it does, I can tell you from experience, to try and get you to do anything at times, it's like trying to turn the Queen Mary, you know?
Yeah.
You've got to keep pushing and pushing and pushing and pushing all the time.
Yeah.
But the bottom line is, you know, it's all about Celtic Football Club and our love of Celtic Football Club. Now, next season, we go for 6 in a row, third time in our history, 2 more than anybody else has. So, to me, the only threat to that is, because the reality is, we know it's a new co, we know they founded in 2012, but the reality is they've got to sell 45,000 season tickets for mm-hmm. Ibrox every week next season.
Mm-hmm.
That makes them a threat to us. The only threat that can come for us, from them to us, is if we eat ourselves and are all each other's throats and whatever.
Mm-hmm.
By all means, we need debate, and I don't think any fans in the world have a board more accountable than Celtic Football Club, because we just jump on them at every opportunity.
Absolutely.
You know? But we always have to remember that the goody Celtic is what matters. And I tell you something right now, I say to you before, I'll say it again, we win next season, then you're on to 7, 8, 9, then you're on to Celtic Park busting at the seams, then you're on to immense glory, and then you're on to being part of history. And hopefully, the 9 and the 10 wipes the steam of Scottish football off that when Rangers cheated away there, because if we can then turn and every time Niall Rose mentions, we can say, well, which one do you want? The one we've done in the 60s and 70s or the one we've just done?
Right.
You know, because we hold all the records anyway, Graham. We're the first to do everything.
Right.
Everybody knows that.
Right.
But Celtic Football Club is so special to so many people, and I've been privileged to go around the world in the last year and just see what it means to guys like Andy Gordon and David Barclay in Perth, Sean Fitzgerald in Melbourne. You know, everywhere you go, there's just Celtic through and through. And you'll know yourself, unless you're on Twitter and social media every single day, a lot of this, the different issues that go around the non-playing side of the club are kind of no as big to them, because they need to fill clubs, and to get to fill clubs, they need a winning team on the park, and they need guys who can point at it and say, that's our manager, that's who we've brought in, etc, etc. And hopefully now Celtic have addressed that and said, you know, let's try and build something here, because it is, I mean, it, you know, standing in the stand on Monday, Graham, and people were singing the Celtic song. Not only were they singing the Celtic song, they sang the whole Celtic song, second verse as well, which is absolutely, just didn't hear that now.
Right.
And as I said, on the homeboys, I'll say again, the thing that will be ringing through your ears all next season, when you go to sleep, when you're picking up your kids, when you're trying to get them to sleep, will be Brendan Rodgers, Fenian Army.
And long may it last, absolutely. You know, I think that exactly what you talked about with wiping the slate clean of all the cheating, you know, when we get to 10 in a row, it's so important, and it's such a huge opportunity. And I mean, from a historic standpoint, I mean, it's making history, but it's making the type of history that our grandchildren are going to be talking about and their children are going to be talking about. I mean, Jesus, we talk about Hampden and the Sun that took place nearly 60 years ago. This is like, you know, on a completely different stratosphere, mm-hmm. and it puts them back, you know, where they belong. To your point, Celtic was the club that broke the records first, that was the first to 6 and 9 in a row. We're still the only and will be the only club that has won the European Cup. You know, these are the things that identify Celtic and that we hold so much pride in. And you talk about 13,000 people turning up to Celtic Park for the announcement of a manager, and then for Brendan Rodgers to come out and say a few words for several minutes, mm-hmm. and people leaving, and they're happy. They're happy because they see a trajectory now. They see the audacity that's been injected back into the club, and now they have hope. They have hope for the future that, you know, this isn't going to be just a situation where, I mean, Celtic is always Celtic. Let's not kid ourselves. No matter what, best year, worst year, Celtic is, you know, one of the greatest clubs in the world. But there's something magical that's going on right now in terms of the intent, in terms of the trajectory. I mean, this is a statement of intent that has happened with Brendan Rodgers. And one of the aspects that I think, I mean, obviously a name like that, he could have been pegged for many jobs in the Premiership, but he chose Celtic. And like you said, lifelong Celtic supporter. So there's that. He's an accomplished manager. I mean, he's Steven Gerrard falling on his ass away from winning the Premiership a couple of years ago. Now he's with us. But one of the aspects that I think is very important to me and very exciting to me is the fact that he has a history of not just coming in and taking a heap of money, gutting the entire side, and then bringing in all of his players. You know, he has a history of taking younger players that were existing and getting the best out of them. Mm-hmm. And not just injecting a particular system, you know, like 4-2-3-1 and mm-hmm. nothing else. You know, he has shown an ability to adapt. You know, he had a different system at Reading than he had it at Swansea. And it was based off the players that he had and putting them into the most successful positions that he possibly could. And then at Liverpool, I mean, he had several different renditions of tactics and formations. And not just over the course of his time there, but over the course of particular games. I mean, he's incredibly intelligent on the fly. I mean, he's not afraid to make tactical decisions based on how an opponent is presenting themselves within the first half. It's so rare, and that's what I'm really excited about in watching Celtic going forward, is that pliability, that elasticity with the tactics and with the strategy and the formations. Neil Lennon had a bit of that at fits and starts, but I mean, it's not fair to hold Neil Lennon to the same the same accountability. I mean, this was his first job. I mean, not just first big job, this is his first job. Yeah. Brendan Rodgers has a documented history of this. And I absolutely cannot wait to see what the product of all this is going to be. Because in addition to his focus on wanting to develop the players that we have now, he knows what, and he's going to be able to find out what we need to supplement what we already have to take us to the next level, so that Malmo's and teams of that ilk are not going to stand in our way as we go towards Europe. I absolutely can't wait.
Yeah, I mean, just so the first of all on the wiping assistant thing. I mean, you know, let's be clear. You know, Celtic win the next five titles, get 10 in a row. That makes it 16 titles in 21 years, which also is comparable to what happened in the 60s and 70s and 80s. Therefore, it isolates that period with Rangers' dominance as being, yeah, that's because they cheated. And if they hadn't, just imagine what we would have won, you know?
Mm-hmm.
But let's also be clear that if, you know, the EBTs are deemed illegal, the club, Celtic, is going to really go to town on them and say, look, we'll put a... Because this is all about, as we know, sporting advantage. And that was, oh, well, EBTs are legal and therefore they sporting advantage. Well, if they're deemed illegal, that means they get sporting advantage and we fucking get the title stripped ASAP. In terms of Brendan Rodgers, I think it's a great point you made with tactics and that. Brendan Rodgers started at Liverpool with a 4-2-3-1, and then that quickly developed into a 4-3-3 when he realised he had Suarez and Sturridge and Sterling. You know, and he was quite adaptable to that, you know, no problem at all. And that's what good football managers do. Like, they didn't have a system. They look at the players and they say, this is what how we'll play. We asked him how he would play, and he said he likes fast attacking football. He likes people to win the ball back early. And he talked about how possession, and he loves a passing game, quick passing. He loves triangles on the pitch, as we've seen with Swansea. And let's not forget that, you know, he took Swansea up through the playoffs and then made them 11th in the Premier League after spending only £12 million. So there is comparisons there about what he could do at Celtic. But more importantly, I think, as you say, what he's Brendan Rodgers done is he's just injected life into the Celtic world, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
At a time when we really needed it. And my prediction is that you'll probably see quite quickly in the next 2 months the feelings you're on a dialer.
Yeah.
In comparison to what Brendan Rodgers can do with these players in this football club.
Well, specifically, I mean, you know, many folks, and myself included, have liked to have a moan over the past several months about players like Christie and Scott Allen and sometimes even Rodgick not getting a look and not being utilized in a useful type of manner. And I think at this point, Brendan Rodgers is going to know exactly what to do with these players, and they're going to get time.
Yeah, and, you know, it's kind of one of the things where, you know, we seem to start playing well the minute we found out Ronnie Dyla was going to be there next season.
Yeah.
And in particular, that Motherwell game, which was absolutely fantastic.
Yeah.
Shackles came off, and I cannot remember again the last time I've seen such a one-sided football match. I don't think Motherwell laid a glove on us that day. And it wasn't like, I mean, not quite a wee bit of their own holidays and that, but they were still trying. They just tore them to pieces, and you get things off, you know, Tierney's first goal, Jack Aitchison's first touch, 16-year-old, 77 days.
Fantastic.
I mean, it's just like, oh my God, this is unbelievable. So the good feeling that started then, and then it was kind of pushed even further with Brendan Rodgers. And what was brilliant was, you know, they announced the Friday afternoon for a Monday press conference, so they captured everything, which is good PR for once. But you had, you know, so-called journalists 2 days before saying there's no chance Brendan Rodgers will fucking take the Celtic job.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
And that's great. And that, what that tells you is these journalists do not have a clue about how Celtic Football Club operates or what's going on there. And that's a great thing.
Yeah, for sure.
You know? It does mean that there is more reliance on club media because, you know, it'd be easy for me to, oh, listen, just follow me, I'll tell you everything. You know, that's no fucking case at all. But the club media, you know, are pushing out, and it's great for somebody like yourself, and I'm sure it's replicated all around the world. You've came home for work, and you've watched back the video on the day that Brendan Rodgers was unveiled, and it was a great video.
Yep.
You know, behind the scenes, showed you everything that's going on, and it's, you know, very much my experience of when I was there. And it's great because then that's you being brought into the football club.
Yeah, exactly.
You know, yep. You can't be there physically, but we'll bring you in like this. And that's something new. You know, we've got things like, I'm one of the things I've been trying to do, because it's hard to actually talk about this because you kind of like, oh, blow your own trumpet. Like, I never mentioned this anywhere ever. You know, I was part of the thing that pushed for a Hillsborough tribute with the families, and I ended up being able to carry the banner on the pitch, which was unbelievable.
Yeah.
You know, with the families and stuff like that. And yeah. But the reason, one of the reasons that happened was because I'd been saying for ages this, that, and next thing. And then in the 6 months before it, I'd seen, you know, the verdict's coming. But you never knew what the verdict was going to be. And for the minute that verdict happened, it was kind of like, right, you need to do something, and it cannot be half-assed. You know, it can't be just a wee token effort. And that kind of came out of it. I've been pushing like fuck to get as many of the team and Lawwell and manager to Vegas next year, because it's the 50th anniversary of Lisbon, obviously.
Yep.
But there are so many people out there who would kill for access to these people.
Oh my God.
You know, and I think we have to do it. You know, I mean, I'll be honest with you, right? Like, when I brought it up, I said it to Lawler about 3 months ago. I said, you need to go. And he's got this thing where two CEOs went and were quickly sacked after it. Not because he had anything done in Vegas, but he laughed about that, whatever. And I was sat to say to him, I said, look, I don't know what your fucking perception of people at Vegas is. I said, these are the best people in the world. Like, these people eat, sleep, and breathe the Celtic Football Club. And they deserve somebody like you to go over there, and so they can ask you questions, and they deserve a manager, and they deserve players and all that kind of thing.
Well, think about the opportunity to mend fences. Like, we are ready. We are ready to, you know, to come in and, you know, forgive and forget. I mean, it's nothing personal, but it, like, the statement, to your point, that it would make by him coming over and making a statement like they've made in announcing this manager, it would be massive.
Yeah, and it goes back to what I said at the start. How many things can be solved with simply a conversation?
Exactly.
You know, whether you disagree or agree, here's my reasonings for doing this, and then we can have a debate about it.
Right.
And I also say to him, I said, look, if you're worried about Heckey's, I said, remember who runs the show? Tam Donnelly. I said, Jiggy's going to, you know, he's going to let anybody do anything.
Yeah, he'll sort anything right out immediately.
He's himself laughing about that. So pushing on that, pushing on, you know, Americans and Australians and all that, get them involved, empower them, get the fans and all that kind of thing to reach out all the time, as much as I can. And other people are doing it as well, and, you know, and stuff like that. Because that's what we need, you know, what I see, Graham, is you get that collective and you've got a fucking juggernaut on your hands.
No,
you know?
Question.
And we're all going, and that's what it's all about. You know, we've been through all this pish, and we've been cheated and financially and all this kind of thing. Now we need to drive it in and say, right, we are Celtic Football Club. And you're right, it's the magic that comes to it. Now, I've had a few conversations and sittings and meetings with Pat Woods, who's like the historian on Celtic.
Yeah.
The guy is a fucking walking Celtic wiki. And he said to me something nobody's ever said to me before. He said, I mean, the guy knows about everything in football. He said, but I can't say with certainty about clubs outside of Britain because I don't know enough about every club in the world. Which isn't really a bad thing.
No.
Does anyone? But he says, I'm telling you now, in terms of British football, there is no club on the fucking island that has a history that can be compared with Celtic.
No chance. Not even close.
And you think, this is what it's all about.
Yep.
That is what it's all about. This is why we support Celtic. It's not about results. We want to win, of course we do. But if we, you know, if it was about results, let's go to the Champions League final and support Real Madrid.
Right.
You know, but don't worry that, because I'll support Celtic.
It's an identity.
Yeah, exactly. And I've said it, other people have said that, I've said it on Twitter and that kind of thing. St. Pauli are loved around the world because they stand up for their own identity and they don't give a fuck who fucking is offended by it. That's what we need to do.
Exactly.
There's nothing to be, the only people that are offended by our identity and who we are bigots. And who gives a fuck about Embra?
Exactly. Amen to that. And we're 100% behind you with that, Paul, and we appreciate the efforts through that. Paul, what's going on with you personally? I've been following you on Facebook and Twitter as well. It seems like everything's coming together nicely with the film, Anyone But Celtic. How's everything going with that?
It's going really well. It's I was doing Liverpool Wednesday, Thursday, Friday the other day, and voiceover work and stuff to camera, pieces to camera and stuff like that. And the difference between this film and the last film was like night and day in terms of my sort of productivity, because that was obviously the first time I'd ever done that, and I was quite nervous and fluffing lines that. Whereas I was really, you know, sort of comfortable this time.
Yeah.
So that's gone really well. we would like to think that we'll have a rough edit by about the end of August. We've got a lot of interviews and that stuff today and things today, but we're on the right track with that, and I would expect to have another trailer ready by the 1st of September.
Excellent.
Which should be good.
Excellent.
We've had conversations about music and what music we can get and all that. That's gone really well. We've got a good linear structure there. And, we've got people who know what they're doing. You know, I've done a podcast with Jai that will come out later. Jai's the director, and I said, you know, I keep saying, you bring a professionalism, your company brings a professionalism, but actually what you bring, it's a nice way of saying you actually know what the fuck you're doing. You know, and so we've got...
Makes a difference.
Yeah, exactly. Him's director, I've got Ian as a cameraman, I've got Paul as a graphics guy. And that really, really does help. Apart from that, what I'm doing right now is I'm writing a play, which is something I've never done before, and it's based on a story that I put out about 6 weeks ago, which regarding my father, the last time we had won five in a row, which was at Tynecastle, May 28th, 1970. And he got arrested three times that day for being thrown out and whatever, and then from the jail and getting a, because he's only 24 year old, and getting a fucking, you know, yelling to his brother and his father and his mother. He gets up on a Sunday and hitchhikes down to Elland Road for the European Cup semi-final, you know, and all the edits. So I thought, you know what, and then people have got a huge impact on it as a vlog. It was like, you know, you could do this or something, and I spoke to a guy who got working with on things in the future, a guy called Frank O'Hooley, who's been still game Guardians of the Galaxy and all that, and kind of say to him, you know, I think you'd be phenomenal at the part of my dad's brother, because he's at that time, my dad's brother was obviously younger, had a big beard like Fran does, big guy in that, and Fran's a phenomenal actor. So I thought, I can get these professionals in to actually do this play. Then I thought, I don't know, I can get John Farrell for the canvas art to do scenery. I thought I could actually do this, like, you know. So what I've then done is, because obviously my father passed away in 1998, is I've went to my mother and had looked through all the photos for the wedding photos and all that kind of thing, so that I could build up an image of what the clothes that he wore, the music he was into, all that kind of thing, some background, all that. I'm in the next week or so going over to his two sisters in Fife to tell us this, because they obviously, my mother only met him in 1973 and then quickly got engaged and married all within that year. So she didn't know him before then, but obviously his sisters did. And it's quite funny because, you know, like, one of his sister Kathleen in particular, there was a gap between Francis and Mary, his big brother and sister, and Kathleen and him, because his father was in the Second World War.
So
there was a gap. Yeah. So him and Kathleen were really close. So I'd say to her, you know, could I come over and talk? Anything you want, blah, blah, blah. Go through the photos, get the stories, you know, things that could be added in. She said, I must tell you, she said, he was very protective of me, especially in terms of boyfriends, you know. And I said, all right. She said, oh, you know, people fucking when they come near me, blah, blah, blah. And she said, I actually don't know how Andrew, who's her husband, got through the net. Now, the funny thing about it is...
That must be an amazing story.
Yeah, this is absolutely true. My father was his best man, and he was my father's best man. But when Andrew married Kathleen, his sister... standing at the altar waiting for it to come down, my old man standing beside him. Apparently, and it's 100% true, my Uncle Andrew turned around and looked at my old man and fainted.
What do you think he was going to do him or something?
You know, that's the thing. People say, maybe he was just subconsciously thinking, you know, the pressure was got to him too much, like, you know. So I am chasing all that and all that because, you know, like, he, you know, he was arrested three times. The whole story, he was arrested three times and he got out twice because he knew the policeman and managed to get back into the game.
Jesus.
And it's getting thrown out for the same shit over and over again. And then
he goes down to Leeds the next day.
Yeah, well, he walked for 2 days and then got picked up. He got picked up by a guy called Lex McLean, who's a Rangers supporter, was a top comedian in Scotland, who not only gave him a lift to Elland Road, but also gave him a ticket. And so that was him sorted. And then he dropped him off in a city centre, walked to a bar, and his brother was in the bar. So when my old man told that story, you know, he would be like, oh, brilliant, had all this escapades, walk in a bar, your Uncle Francis stands there. My Uncle Francis tells the story, he said, cost me a fucking fortune. You know what I mean? The two sides, I want to bring that in here as well. Two-act play, basically. But aye, so, you know, I wanted to really kind of deal with that, right, deal with the background of that, right, and that, because I thought, as I said earlier, people say, oh, dialogue's the thing you do best. Well, that's what play is, isn't it? Really, it's dialogue. So
that's it.
You know, let's kind of do that, and then try to, we talked to some historians and people with collections, and kind of immerse myself in that time period of March 28th, 1970, April 1st, 1970. Not just about Celtic, but in terms of what's happening in the world at that time. I think Bridge Over Troubled Waters was the number one at the time with Simon and Garfunkel, things like that, you know. So I can write all that into it and things, you know. So I'm really, really looking forward to that, because obviously I hope it's going to be funny and all that, but I think it will be hopefully a nice tribute to him.
That sounds fantastic.
And also, it just, every time I look at it, I just think, you win five in a row at Tynecastle, you go to the Elland Road and beat Leeds 1-0 in the European Cup semi-final. What a time to be alive.
Can you imagine?
Oh, I mean, it just doesn't get any better, does it? So that's going to kick up the rest of our time, basically. So.
Fantastic. Well, I'm really looking forward to that. I mean, you definitely piqued my interest. So
yeah, it'll be a premiere at Celtic Park, October 7th, 2017.
Fantastic. Well, we'll be looking forward to the play down the road. Anyone but Celtic, in the more near term, certainly looking forward to that and seeing the final product. But in the meantime, the IRA Block, reach out to Paul, PayPal, westillwon@hotmail.com. Until Tuesday, yeah, £10 anywhere in the world. Can't beat that. Signed copy? I mean, come on.
Yeah.
All right.
Yeah, it doesn't get any better than that.
It really doesn't. Paul, thank you so much. It was great catching up.
Thank you.
All the best. And we'll catch up soon, I'm sure.
Absolutely. It was a pleasure, Graham.
All right. Fantastic. And thank you to the listeners for joining us today. Hail, hail, and keep the faith. We'll talk to you soon.